Hi, I'm Yiorgos Mylonadis. Can you hear me? I think you can. Yes, fantastic. And you did choose, you know right, that you chose the session that said developing strategy for value creation.
Yes,
very good. So I use this long title because that has all the right words in it, value creation, strategy, developing. But of course, I'm going to do a bait and switch and talk about something a little bit more narrow. So still about value creation, but because that is the title actually of a course that I run at London Business School, which is an open enrollment course that talks about lots of things around strategy, and it's not just me, but it's also my colleagues. Within that five-week course, there's one session that I talk about specifically ecosystems. So I want to talk a little bit about ecosystems and explain, do come here, explain what is the logic behind talking about ecosystems. And how do we think differently about the creation of value in ecosystems? So also just another word about this idea of value, creating value, as opposed to capturing value or sustaining value. So when in strategy, we talk quite a bit about how you extract value, but we spend probably less time talking about how do you create value. And so here the emphasis again is on creating new value, if you will, coming up with new ideas. Okay. Now, just a note about the context here. I know that there are multiple, I'm hearing multiple voices, so probably you are doing the same. And if at some point you want me to talk louder and shout over them or talk more low, let me know, okay? So ecosystems. So in case you fall asleep over the next 30 seconds, as Costa said, let me just tell you what I'm going to tell you here so that you know. Also, feel free if you want to go and shop around and hear a little bit from the other talks. I'm perfectly happy with that. It's in the spirit of the day, I think. So competitive advantage in ecosystems. What's my point here? My point is that there's a very rare kind of competitive advantage that we find in a particular kind of ecosystem. Ecosystem is a very broad metaphor. So I'm talking about a very particular kind of ecosystem, which is kind of an extreme case. And that's the environment where collaborators compete and competitors collaborate. Okay, so this is a very special kind of an ecosystem. But always when we teach people, it's very good to think about the extreme case, because from that we can generalize to a much broader range. So it's a very different kind of competitive advantage, very rare, very hard to find, and it doesn't last for too long. This competitive advantage is based on using co-specialized assets to mind your customer's business. To mind as in not mind the gap, beware, but mind as in take care, think about your customer's business. So I'm using two words here, co-specialized assets and minding your customer's business. What do I mean by these two words? So co-specialized assets means traditionally we think that we've got a competitive advantage because we are particularly good at what we do. Or if we don't have the right competitive advantage, we partner with someone else who is best at what they do. So both of those things matter, but actually what I'm saying here about co-specialized assets is that you are very good at what you do, and someone else is very good at what they do, but it's how the two of you can work really, really well together that gives you the competitive edge. It's not just about you being a good company and me being a good teacher, but it's me understanding exactly the kind of need that you have, and you understanding exactly what I can offer to you, and then working very well together. That combination is what gives us the competitive advantage. And you can imagine right away that this is something that will not last for too long. And that's why it's rare to have that connection. So that's about co-specialized. And about minding, what I mean with that is that when you mind your customer's business, there are a number of things that are going on here. One is you anticipate the needs of your user. In other words, think about your user needs before even your user knows about their needs. And also understand how your user combines value propositions. You are providing one product, one service to your user, to your customer. That's one value proposition. And then you say, that's fine. I made a sale. I'm successful. Customer is satisfied. Job done. Yeah, but the customer also gets a complementary value proposition from someone else. And then they have to do the hard work of patching things up and making them work together. To the extent that you know what goes in your customer's business or mind or day-to-day life to combine those two things together, and you can combine them for him or her, then that gives you an edge. So you need to anticipate the user needs and understand how they combine value propositions. You need to solve problems before problems arise for your customer. And finally, because of you're doing that, you're not just caring about satisfying your customer, product works, but you care about delighting your customer in the sense that you fulfill those user needs that they have not even anticipated yet. Now, Oh, if this sounds too good to be true, it is because indeed there is hard work involved here. You need to watch out because there's a lot of friction when you collaborate with partners who sometimes are your competitors and sometimes are your collaborators. There's a lot of friction and you need to deal with that friction. There's a lot of overhead. But on the positive side, you benefit from the fact that sometimes in an ecosystem, together with these partners who are kind of uncomfortable bedfellows, you can create innovations that you could not do on your own. Okay. So that's the summary. Okay. So I'll try to kind of bring this to life with a couple of examples and a couple of points. So I'm going to go a little bit deep into certain points of this. And in the general scheme of things, as far as these presentations go, this is a bit more technical than probably, say, Costas's discussion a bit earlier, just a tiny bit. So imagine you go back in time. What is that? 27 years ago, the year is 1990. And you look around, okay? You're a technical person, you're an engineer. You look around and you see some things like that. Believe it or not, this is what existed in 1990. And you look at those things and immediately, being the technically minded person you are, you say all of those things have some things in common. What would that be? A screen, yes, very good. But let me throw, this here, or these, no screen there. What do they have in common? Plastic, yes. Software, programs, very good. And programs, in order for programs to run, they need hardware, very good. Chips. And the other thing that these things have in common is they need chips because they have electronics. And the other thing that they have in common, batteries. They have batteries. So it's very hard to plug those in the wall outlet and take that solar-powered car by MIT and drive it around, okay? So they have batteries. And therefore, the chip that you need to build is a chip that needs to live off the grid. It needs to be able to consume low energy. You might say, that was obvious, Yiorgos, I knew that. But if you had thought about that back in 1990, you would have created a chip called? The one that ARM created. Now, when I say chip, which is the first company that comes to mind? Intel. So here you have an established company, basically, for all practical purposes, a monopolist. They own the industry, right? They can defend against any incoming attack, and yet ARM is able to, make the decision back in 1990 that they're not going to provide consulting services, which is their other options. These are people who design chips, so they could be a design shop. 12 people, no cash in the bank, they could be just a design shop, offer services. Instead, they say, we understand how people use all of those things that I showed you before and many more that where the ARM chip is used since then. We know how people use those things. What we can do best actually is define the global standard for chips. So we're not going to providing individual services, customizing our offering for every different customer that comes to us and says, please design a chip that. But we're going to go back to the drawing bench and try to define a standard for chip design that can be used across all of these applications. And so, that was a pretty good move, right? So these are three companies. The red line, this line is ARM. This line is Apple. And this line is Intel. Now, you should always take these lines with a grain of salt because everything depends on where you start to draw the line. But this is over a 10-year period, really. And over a 10-year period, and this is the last 10 years, Apple ARM and Apple have done really substantially better than Intel. Now, still, Intel is a more valuable company than ARM, and so is Apple, by the way. But the improvement has been over the last 10 years much higher for those two. Not surprisingly, both of these are ecosystem plays. The big jump is because Apple created the App Store. That's what gave them the edge. And the big jump here with ARM is something similar. So ARM, just to complete the facts on them, they were sold off just in the autumn, a few months ago. They were sold off for $32 billion to SoftBank. Their PE rating at the time was 68. And they created all of this value of $32 billion with just 4,000 employees. Okay. So this is an amazing creation of value, right? So that's one point about, you know, value creation. The second point, I told you I'm going to talk about value creation in ecosystems, is that when you go to ARM's website, I should add until very recently, because yesterday when I checked it, it didn't look exactly like this, but it doesn't matter. When you go to ARM's website, you don't need to click too deep down. Very quickly, you get a picture that looks like this and says a collaborative business model. And in here, it has all of these partners. And some of these partners are just complementers. So ARM designs chips. They do not manufacture chips. So when it says semiconductor companies, these are the companies that manufacture the chips. When it says OEMs, these are the companies that use the chips, and so on. But for example, here, design tools, ARM has design capabilities. So it collaborates with companies that also produce design tools, but ARM also produces its own design tools. So some of these partners, actually, ARM competes with. It also has operating system designers with whom it collaborates and competes. And how do we know that they compete with them? We know that because they actually produce, their collaborators produce valuable enough product that ARM licenses it from them. So in a way, these are your competitors. But at the same time, these are your partners with whom you are developing your product. Now, when you go and look at this, why do you think they do that? What is the incentive for ARM to make this very public statement? Or to put it differently, if I were to go to your company's website, well, those of you anyway that I know, I know I would not see something like that, but maybe I don't know all the companies that are represented here for sure. If I go to your company's website, would I see a picture like this? Not really. Definitely not in Mars. I know that. Why do these guys go out of their way instead of, you know, describing their products and services? Why do they go out of their way of talking about their partners? Why do you think they do that? Any guesses? It is what they are. It is what makes the value. So the value, you're saying, is not just them, but it is the fact that they can bring all of these partners together. Very good. What is the message that this sends to the partners or to prospective partners? We're open for business. We can collaborate. Do join us, right? So there's a clear message here to potential partners coming in. What about users? Users say...
Yeah, it means then that you've got access to a lot more than just one.
That's right. Exactly. So it becomes a gate to access the broad network. And who else is this a message to? We said the big boy here is Intel. What is the message to Intel when they look at this? What is the warning for Intel? If you were to attack us, we have lots of friends. You're going to make lots of people unhappy. And by the way, of course, these people also work with Intel. So think twice before attacking us, right? Which doesn't mean that Intel has not tried to enter. They have tried twice to enter. They made it an official strategy to enter into this market, and twice they failed. By the way, up until a few years ago, Intel's name was here as well, and Intel made them take it down for obvious reasons, right? They're still collaborating with Intel. So, and they say this in black and white. They say, this community exists not just to enable the uptake of ARM technology, but also as an extensive competitive advantage and barrier to entry for intellectual property companies providing technologies in the same areas as ARM. Now, I don't know if any of you has a legal background, but you know, if someone were to come out and say, I'm doing something to make it harder to enter to my competitors so I can own the market, do you think this could be a problem with regulators? Normally, it is, right? So what do you think is going on here? The lawyers, they forgot to run this by the lawyers. The lawyers didn't check it. Why is it in this case, in this business model, why is this not the problem? It is the community. So the the barrier to entry is not the ARM. The barrier to entry is this ecosystem, which does not belong to ARM. ARM does not have ownership of this ecosystem. Why are these players there? They want to be. They want to be. If tomorrow they decide to walk, they walk. So I have, see what's going on? My competitive advantage comes from this community, which I do not own. I do not have direct control over them. I need to entice them to want to be with me, which of course gives rise to the question, what on earth am I offering to them? So if you look at what ARM has been offering over time, it started by offering this solution, the technical solution, a chip that works well but consumes little energy. It then moved on to find good, excellent chip manufacturing companies to join forces with them, like Texas Instruments, for example, because all ARM does is design. They don't produce. No assets, no hard assets. And finally, what ARM is basically good at now, the key value that it is offering to all of these partners, is their ability to help the partners do technical advances faster than they would if they were operating on their own, and also help them identify adjacent markets, nearby markets, new opportunities. Right? So the benefit to me as a partner to ARM is that if I were to choose not to be part of this, I would not be able to be part of the flow of information that goes through this network. Which again, probably makes us think, so what is ARM doing to create that flow of information? Otherwise, you know, we can just put a, you know, a nice picture there that says we're a community, but somehow you need to sustain that community. And basically what ARM is doing to sustain this community, it puts a lot of resources behind this facilitation of knowledge flow. So it manages a network of people who talk to one another. This network is powered, is driven by the partners, these partners. So they sometimes lead some of the discussions about new product areas, about new technologies, new standard, new architectures. And ARM is orchestrating that conversation, kind of like IBM's jam sessions of a few years ago. So, but ARM is doing that day in, day out, because if they are to stop that dissemination of information, then the whole purpose of being part of this community would go away. So there are two things, just to summarize this Intel's ARM story. There are two things that ARM is doing to create value. One thing that they do is they mind the customer. They mind the customer. There's a nice case that our friend, Peter Williamson has written on ARM. And in that he says, he quotes some of the executives who say, our business is working out the right answers for the world. So what they do is the executives are trying to understand what are the issues that the OEMs, that the, you know, Googles and Nokias of the world are going to face in the future, and then work their way back to their bench, to the design bench, to design the operating chip that is going to solve those problems. So they step into the shoes of the customer and think ahead of the customer to provide the solution that the customer is going to be facing. And the other thing that they do is, although they understand very well the individual verticals, the different kinds of uses for these chips, they do not customize their chips. I mean, to a degree, but basically they do not customize their chips for every different vertical. Their chips are fairly generic so that they can be used across different kinds of product lines, if you will. But in order to get to that point, I need to know very well how each one of those products is using the chip. Otherwise, I cannot design. Okay? So you see, it's a kind of a tension there, because you need to go very deep into the use, but then restrain yourself from the temptation to customize and go back and see how you can make it general. And that's the idea of building a standard. So that's about minding the customer's business. And the second thing that they do is they manage their partners. You can imagine, such a large community, different kinds of interests. What you need to do here is, you essentially, to put it in metaphorical terms, you need to leave some money on the table. You need to make sure you do not extract any ounce of value that you can from your partners. You need to think about maintaining those relationships for the longer term. So they say, we develop a roadmap, not just a product. And the purpose of the roadmap is we communicate this to our partners so that they know what to expect is coming down the road. We don't just tell them, this is a product that we want you to develop. And with every time we make a change, and we need to make lots of changes, as you can imagine, in this environment, we think through how the proposed changes in architecture are going to impact our partners. Because our partners depend, their livelihood is dependent on them actually getting value out of the participation in the ecosystem. Otherwise, they'll defect. They'll go to Intel's ecosystem. So those two things is what constrains you or enables you to design new solutions for your customers. The solutions are limited only by your ability to mind the customer needs and your ability to manage the variety of partner offerings. Okay? So if you can manage your partners over whom you have no direct control, and if you can mind your customer, think of what is coming ahead for them and how they combine value propositions, you can bring new partners to develop new value propositions and that you can offer to them and they can use down the road. So that's the story of ARM, if you will. And this highlights this issue of minding the customer and managing the partners. I'm sure you've been to the movies recently. And this is La La Land, yes? So you can think now, I'm using this again metaphorically here. Usually I use videos when I teach, but in the interest of time and echo here, I'm not. But I can use a picture. So La La Land, imagine of a company which is operating in La La Land. So they are a very different company than yours, I'm sure. And they think of addressing their investors very differently, probably, than your company does. So they say, dear investor, in their IPO prospectus, we have some messages to convey to you now that we're going public. Our essential partners could leave us, you tell your investors. We do not, just read the red letters here. There's a lot of text here, okay? We do not have agreements with logistics and delivery companies, which are essential in this model, that require them to offer services to our sellers. So these are essential players. We don't have agreements with them. We do not have any agreements that require these third-party participants to provide services to sellers, in case you didn't get it. Okay, so we need these partners. We have no service agreements with them. Our actions could hurt our profitability, you tell your investors. These are actual quotes, right? I'm not making this up. Our operating philosophy may negatively influence our short-term financial performance. Consistent with our operating philosophy, we may take actions that fail to generate short-term financial results and cannot assure you, in case you had any doubt, that these actions would produce long-term benefits either. We also make investments in new products and services that may not provide economic benefits to us in the short term or at all. Now, these are, again, statements I would find in your company's websites, yes? Not really? Probably not. So these are the actual statements, but I'll also fill in the gaps, right? So this is the same text, it's just adding the gaps. So our operating philosophy and interest in maintaining the health of our ecosystem may negatively influence our performance. Consistent with our operating philosophy and focus on the long-term interest of our ecosystem, we do all of those things. So we take short-term pain because we value the health of our ecosystem more than our health today. Okay? That's a trade-off. That's the explicit trade-off. And this is a message to the investors because investors need to know before they invest in us. Can you guess which company is this? Uber. It could well be Uber. They've lost the most money faster than anyone else. Actually, these guys don't lose money. They make money. Well, you could have figured it out by now. You know, yes, it actually says here. Tabo. So this is the Alibaba prospectus when Alibaba went public. And Alibaba made this statement to its investors to be clear about their intentions. Now, this is Alibaba. Alibaba just you know what Alibaba is, right? It's like a cross between eBay and Amazon, for example. And Alibaba has all of these marketplaces, what they call marketplaces, like Taobao, Tmall, and so on, where it's like eBay. You buy and sell goods, different kinds of buyers and sellers in each one, but that's basically, it's a transaction that goes on here. And in order to pay for that transaction, you need something like PayPal, and they have something called Alipay. So that's the fundamental idea. So you might say, well, that's eBay, right? eBay has PayPal, eBay has transactions, end of the story. Well, except that eBay took many, many years to decide that it had to divest PayPal, and since divested, PayPal's value went up, eBay's value went up. But eBay initially thought of it not as an ecosystem, thought of it as its own company, right? I own everything, including the payment system. From day one, Alibaba does not own Alipay. That's why you can use Alipay even if you're a competitor to Alibaba. It's still Jack Ma, the owner or big owner of Alibaba, owns Alipay, large chunk of it, but it's not a formal relationship with Alibaba. All of this part here is web services, which support these operations, kind of like Amazon Web Services. They're the third largest web service company in the world. So far, I'm telling you, they're kind of like eBay or like Amazon, with a little twist, which is they figured out from day one that I don't need to own those things. But the other interesting thing as well is that, you know, here they talk about digital entertainment or social network. So they have lots of other ancillary businesses. And what they do is they utilize this platform that they have established in order to see how their customers combine the value propositions to do other things in their life. So initially it's about buying and selling goods, but they realize their customers actually want to use this information that exists in the system, like the ratings, for example, to benefit in other ways. So could I, for example, if I know people who are transacting in this system and they give ratings to, you know, goods and services, could I also trust them to give ratings to songs, for example? And would I value those ratings differently if some of these people were in my friendship network or not? And so Alibaba has started to create other businesses, like this business about introducing new kinds of music to your friends through ratings on new kinds of music. And so think of that as a Spotify that uses all the data that sits on the network to introduce new kinds of music. So dealing with the tail end of the music distribution, if you will, not the big hits. Okay. So this is a very valuable service because it deals with the vast number of music that gets produced and never gets listened to. So we're using the data here to offer a new service to our customers. Also, you know, while we're at it, maybe if you get a credit rating, actually, while you're at it, you have your Alipay account, and there's a little bit of money sitting on that account for your next transaction, why don't I offer to you asset management services? And you can make more money than you can make in any bank in China by leaving the money in the account, and I will invest it for you. So overnight, 400 million people choose to opt into this service, and they get more interest than they would get in any Chinese bank. Suddenly, Alibaba is competing in the banking sector. And while we're at it, given that I have 10 minutes, I have to stop in 10 minutes? No. It's only for lunch, right? It's okay. While we're at it, now that we have all this information about, you know, what is your income and so on and so forth, you're a single person looking for a good single match. Maybe we can match each other on the basis of credit scores.
Not
why not combine? Yes, you can choose. You want to be matched on buying habits or on credit scores. So this is an illustration of, I'm using these guys to juxtapose them to really eBay and Amazon, because I think they do a much better job of, you know, thinking what is the minimum ownership I need to have simply to entice partners to be part of this, but then I rely on their ability to come and join forces with me to develop new services and products. Providing solutions. Right? There is a potential downside to this. The potential downside is, this is their statement. I'm not going to read it. It's about, you know, taking care to manage this ecosystem so people do not cheat in the ecosystem and everyone does their fair share and contribute and so on. And my point here is someone needs to do this, right? So if you really think that this idea of ecosystem is a good idea, you need to invest resources in managing the ecosystem. There can be a downside to this, a negative version of this, which is maybe someone knows too much about your buying habits and your, you know, spending habits and so on. And I, actually, this is an article from The Economist. There was another article in the Wall Street Journal at about the same time, December 2016, which talks about this really dystopian vision of someone having all of this information and being able to dictate how you basically monitoring every second of your life and penalizing you for, you know, going to the tube and using trying to go through the barrier without or using your child's car to go through the barrier for a reduced rate, and that gives you negative penalties in your civic license, and you are downgraded as a. So it can get really, really nasty. And so we need to think carefully about this issue of combining value propositions, because it raises important privacy issues. So although it is very alluring to think, how can I provide solutions to my customers that they have not even thought about, it does make it make the customers a little bit concerned, perhaps, about how you're using their personal data. This is another very long slide, but actually this slide, I think, matters because it goes to the essence of how ecosystems create value. In this particular case, this is a narrow version of an ecosystem. It is the winner-take-all ecosystem. And what it says here is, again, the red letters, our ecosystem drives the livelihood of all of these partners, and therefore their interests are aligned with ours. So all of these partners want to do exactly what we want to do. The second thing is, because there are so many interactions going on there, there is a lot of value that gets created as a result. Okay? Because people rate each other, they learn from each other's behavior, and there's a lot of value that gets created in the ecosystem. And therefore, it produces a self-reinforcing, mutually beneficial network effect. Okay? So this idea of a network effect is crucial. And finally, these network effects do not just stay there. You, given this size, this is the amount of the network effect. Yes, bigger size, bigger network effect. But also, the more I use that network effect, the more, the bigger it gets. So the frequency of interactions, the amount of interactions, creates a bigger network effect. Costas told you, before you shop, you go to Amazon. Why do you shop? Why do you go to Amazon? It's not even the ratings. It's not even the ratings. You go to Amazon because someone has gone there before you. They didn't rate. They didn't shop. They went, they checked like you do, and they go away. But they stepped. And the moment they stepped and they looked at something, that gets registered. And so you go to check for something. I go to check for a new book on strategy. And they told me, you know, the people who looked at this book, they also bought that book. Or they looked at that book. And so I get a lot of information. So the more of us go there, and the more Amazon can use that information to inform us about what others did, the bigger the value that gets created. To summarize this in a in three bullet points, this is based on an article that I wrote a while back. One, in order to have this winner-take-all ecosystem, like a Facebook, for example, there aren't two Facebooks. Maybe there's LinkedIn and Facebook, but there aren't too many. How do you get these winner-take-all ecosystems? One, you need network effects, which is the amount of connections that can happen, what we just said. Two, you need some glue to make it sticky. Once you go there, you shouldn't be able to leave very easily. And so you can see why in an eBay or a Alibaba, because you go there and you establish a reputation, for example, as a seller, it's hard to go away and establish a new reputation somewhere else. And finally, you need bandwagon effects, which means that if someone goes to that ecosystem, you want other people to want to follow in their footsteps. Because if you have network effects, and you make it hard for people to go away, and people have an incentive to join because you've joined for whatever number of reasons. You give them, you know, low price telephone calls if they're part of the family, or, you know, you get the picture. You create some kind of an incentive to join, to follow. Then the result is more and more people go there. And it becomes very, very hard for a competitor to establish a competing ecosystem. How much time? Two. Three. Very good. So I told you about ecosystems. I told you two things so far, essentially. I told you you need to mind your customer. I told you you need to work with your partners because there's a lot of hard work going there. What else have I told you? I've told you that it requires a long-term vision. You need to also to think of what ecosystem you want to design. There are very different purposes of an ecosystem. So I gave you an example of ecosystems that are based on trading, for example. So the purpose of those is to create as many connections as possible to feed off other parts of your business. Other ecosystems are more, you know, fine-tuned for innovation purposes. Procter & Gamble's Connect and Develop is an ecosystem where it basically tries to open up Procter & Gamble's R&D to the world so that it can you know, source ideas from any competent engineer out there. Lego created a user-driven innovation where it asked its users to design new games for them, and this helped them, you know, get the prices, their sales up to the roof a few years back. And finally, outside of the world of business, XPRIZE Foundation, I think, is a fantastic, superb, wonderful, inspiring example of how you can use those ecosystems to generate social innovation, in this case, not just business innovation. So this is essentially, creating, using the platform, the media platform that you have, in order to invite, you put a prize out there, and you invite as many potential contributors as you can to join forces in winning the race for dealing with carbon dioxide that is out there in the atmosphere, or making water filtration very, very cheap, or making lives for women very safe, or helping people figure out how to interact with computers that have a lot of intelligence. So, one, you need to decide what kind of ecosystem you have. Two, you need to delight your users. It's about figuring out what they will need in the future, not just from you, but also from others. This is very hard for companies to do, because as a company, you are thinking, how can I satisfy my users? If I talk to a food company and I tell them, what kind of information can you give about your users, about their life? They say, I'm going to tell them how they can consume this product of mine, and that product of mine, and that product of mine, and that will give them full nutrition. And I'm saying, you know, have you ever seen any customer who consumes only your company's products, food products? Customers consume all sorts of food products. You need to help your user understand, your customer understand, how the combination of food products they consume from your competitors influences their life. Then you have a chance. So delighting your customers means surprising them with giving them information that they normally would not have access to, not just your company information. You need to take good care of your partners, and you need to beware of the winner-take-all sirens, in the sense that this is a pretty good position to be in. And if you can get a bit cocky about it. And if you have a Facebook or an eBay, you might want to make life miserable for your users, because now you're a monopolist. So you need to beware of that if you are in that wonderful spot. So I leave you with one final thought, which is stolen from Ken Chenault, who is the CEO of American Express. And Ken Chenault has a wonderful line that says, become the company that's going to put you out of business if you want to survive for the long term, like American Express has done for 160 years. So I'll just paraphrase that. Become the ecosystem that's going to put you out of business. Okay? And that requires a shift in mindset and a shift in terms of how you manage, you take care of your ecosystem. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you for persevering.